This is crazy. SpaceX resumes stacking operations for Starship's second launch tower. How long till it's done? SpaceX finishes final preparations for Flight 5's catch attempt and gives a new launch estimate. Are they really ready? The mysterious Ship 26 is moved to the Megabay. Will it finally be scrapped? SpaceX's Starfactory is less than a month from completion according to Musk, but is it really? SpaceX has a new crew mission launching by the end of the year and it is going to the poles. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Starbase Texas has quickly grown from a small patch of swampland at the south tip of Texas to the world's most advanced rocket factory and spaceport. And every good spaceport needs its launch pads. So let's check out how the work on those is coming along. Starting with Orbital Launch Tower A. Last episode, we talked about Test Tank B14.1, aka the punching bag. It was rolled back to the launch site and once again placed on the orbital launch mount for testing. Since then, workers have been preparing for this testing, doing near constant work on the orbital launch tower. But why and what are they testing? Most of this work has focused on the chopstick catch arms, which will be used to hopefully catch the super heavy booster on the upcoming test flight. It'll launch, fly up to the edge of space, separate from the Starship, come back down and be caught out of mid-air. Sounds crazy, I know. All this work should culminate in the continued testing of the catch procedures on B14.1. As of now, we've yet to see any of that testing, and it seems SpaceX isn't in too much of a hurry, seeing as they likely won't be able to launch till next month due to paperwork. But testing is likely right around the corner. But it'll take more than that. It'll take more than one tower. If you put one tower at the risk of being hit by a falling rocket booster, you better have a backup, right? Enter Tower B. When we last left Tower B, the sixth segment had just been stacked and the crane had been lowered for its final extension so it could stack the final three segments. After a slight delay due to some mechanical problems on the crane, SpaceX finally completed the extension and raised the massive CC8800-1 crane. With the crane finally up and ready, it is time for segment number 7 of 9. So when we saw a road closure for the night of the 12th, we knew exactly what was coming. Sure enough, segment 7 was placed onto a pair of self-propelled modular transporters, or SPMTs, and rolled down the road to be placed right next to Tower B. It's likely SpaceX plans to stack this segment as soon as possible. If you look closely, you might also be able to tell this tower segment, as well as the two remaining ones, are quite a bit smaller than the rest, being only about half the size. SpaceX did this to allow for easier stacking, as larger, heavier pieces are much harder to stack so high up and can usually only be stacked when there is little to no wind. Imagine Jenga, just with blocks that are hundreds of tons heavy. Heavy. It became a problem with the first tower, as SpaceX needed to wait for the right conditions before stacking. Learning from that mistake, SpaceX decided to change the design a bit, making these top three segments about half the size. And as you can see, it's already been stacked. SpaceX is making quick progress here. They want to be done with stacking before Flight 5. With 7 of 9 tower segments needed to complete the second tower now at the launch site, only 2 remain. So let's take a look at those 2 segments just down the road at the Sanchez site. As a fun fact, the Sanchez site is named after an oil and natural gas company that had a well there before SpaceX came. Along with changes to size, SpaceX has also changed its method of construction, preferring to install most of the internals for the segments on the ground before stacking. On the first tower, SpaceX stacked largely empty segments. They fleshed them out after they were stacked, which turned out to be a huge hassle. One of the tower's pre-installed features is the pulley mechanism on the top segment, which connects to the gigantic Mechazilla arms. This pulley system guides a cable from a drawworks motor at the tower's base up to the top and back down to attach to another pulley mounted on the arms. Drawworks motor might be a strange name to use for this motor. That's because these come straight from old oil rigs. SpaceX is using oil industry components to build these towers. These are the motors that move the drill stack up and down on a regular old oil rig. This allows for the arms to move up and down the tower so it can lift and stack the boosters and chips onto the launch pad. All of these changes have allowed SpaceX to build the tower at a much faster rate. Right now it even seems possible SpaceX will make it happen and finish the tower's main structure before Flight 5. Fingers crossed! If we look just a bit back from these tower modules, we can also see the next ship for Flight 5, Ship 30. This ship is patiently waiting for FAA approval to spread its wings on Flight 5. It's ready, same as Booster 12. In the meantime, SpaceX decided to outfit this next ship with a few cosmetic improvements. Unfortunately, on Ship 29, SpaceX decided to skip this step. Perhaps if they had written S29, its flaps would have stayed together even better. After all, we all know how much cosmetics affect the quality of a flight. Maybe some engine bay lighting as well? What do you think, pimp my Starship? Anyways, jokes aside, workers did finally apply the Ship 30 decal to the side of the ship, and it's really good to see that this made a comeback. I for one love it. With Test Tank 14.1 still at the launch pad, it's likely to be a little bit before we see this ship roll to the pad. But SpaceX may also decide to roll the ship there earlier. It would sure make for a great photo opportunity. We'll keep a lookout for any rollout closure dates signaling the move of a Starship along Highway 4. Moving over from the Rocket Garden to Megabay 2, we have Ship 26. Wait, what? Wasn't Ship 26 in the Rocket Garden? Well, it was. However, on the night of the 13th, SpaceX decided to move Ship 26 from its display stand at the Rocket Garden into Megabay 2. And it appears this may be Ship 26's last move. But before I tell you about that, we've looked into our channel metrics and there are over 2 million monthly returning viewers who have not subscribed yet. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. And while you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter. Why? Because you'll gain access to a massive amount of extra content. With it, you get access to daily new Starbase photo galleries, including all those we've posted so far. Satellite, aerial, and ground photos, more than 400 posts in the past 2 years alone, with up to 7 picture galleries per week. Insights, chats with me, you name it. And no matter how much you decide to give, everyone gets the same supporter content and access, no tiers, you decide what it's worth to you, you rock. You and I knew this was coming. At this point, we rocket watchers have said Ship 26 days were over multiple times, and have been wrong every time. So until we actually start seeing sparks fly and lines cut, I'm not going to say anything for sure. So I've been bombarded with spam calls from random changing numbers. It turns out data brokers collected and sold my personal information, including my private phone number. So if you want to call me, maybe give them a call. This happens every time you surf the web, leaving your personal data everywhere. Luckily for all of us, we have a long-term relationship with my sponsor, Incogni. Think of Incogni as the Starship of online security, powerful, efficient, and designed for massive tasks. They contact data brokers on your behalf, requesting the removal of your personal data and handling any objections. Thanks, guys! It's fully automated, just create an account, grant Incogni permission to work for you, and watch them clean up the mess. Doing this yourself would be like trying to colonize a new planet with a non-reusable rocket. Why would you even try that? With Incogni, you get progress reports, a 30-day money-back guarantee. Use code Felix at the link below and get 60% off an annual plan. Protect your privacy and support What About It at the same time. Visit incogni.com/felix to get started. But just after Ship 26 was moved to the Megabay, its engines were removed, showing that at least something was going on. As of recording, Ship 26 is still standing in the Megabay, although given what we know so far, it is unlikely to stay that way. It'll be sad to see this ship go when it finally gets scrapped, but we've known this was likely coming for a while. Ship 26 began construction all the way back in October of 2022, so by Starship standards, it's ancient, with only Ship 20 being older. The other thing is the fact that Ship 26 was built to be expendable. No flaps, no heat shield, or even a payload bay. Just a giant stainless steel tube. Its sister ship, Ship 27, was built around the same time and had an anomaly during testing before being scrapped not too long after. When these two expendable ships were built, we theorized they might be rapid test prototypes so SpaceX could launch ships quickly, so they could test Starship as fast as possible. However, ship development speeds ramped up, so these quickly built expandable ships were no longer needed. Ship 26 outperformed many of our expectations and theories as it continued to stay around long after it seemed useless. SpaceX even added reinforcements around the nose cone for some reason. Most recently, it was the first ship to be tested at Massey's static fire stand. So clearly, SpaceX had some uses for it. However, following the static fire, SpaceX may have gotten its full use out of Ship 26. And SpaceX is not known to be the sentimental type. It's highly likely that this will in fact be Ship 26's final move. But as I've said in the past, it still wouldn't surprise me if it was outfitted with lunar engines and flown to the moon instead. Ship 26 has had a wild history. Let's move over to the old high bay now, where Ship 31 continues with its heat tile work. Teams have continued to focus on the glued areas near the nose cone and weld lines. Here we can see workers grinding the surface of Ship 31's nose cone. This is done partly to clean off any remaining old adhesive and partly to scratch the surface of the stainless steel. But why would they want to scratch its nose? I mean, they scratch it to improve the surface for what's to come, tile adhesive. This works by increasing the surface area of the adhesive to make contact with. If this wasn't done, the adhesive would have a much weaker bond. If you've ever tried to glue something onto a piece of bare metal, you know how hard it can be. However, even light sanding can increase the strength of the bond by huge amounts. Each and every fine groove or scratch in the surface gives the glue something extra to hold onto. Moving down from the nose cone, we can also see that SpaceX appears to have finished the tile removal on this weld seam and is now cleaning the glue residue from down there as well. Now that these adhesive sections have been removed, workers should start moving onto the rest of the tiles. Most of this flight hardware was built quite a while ago. Ship 32, the newest flight-ready ship, completed its construction nearly a year ago, in November 2023. That's been a while. This huge gap in Starship construction was caused by SpaceX's focus shift to the machine that builds the machine, the Starfactory. SpaceX has been hard at work building the world's most advanced rocket production facility. This entire complex arguably is a world first. There are other rocket factories out there, but none of them is capable of mass producing its rockets. This includes the main building of the Starfactory, the base, and the office building. This machine has quite a few moving parts, and it isn't quite finished yet either. In typical SpaceX style, even though it's not finished, the Starfactory has already produced its first chips. For example, the first of the newly redesigned Block 2 Starships, Ship 33, was produced just recently. But the Starfactory gets closer to completion every day. Musk even stated shortly before Flight 4 that it would be fully filled with equipment in 3 months. That means that theoretically all of the manufacturing equipment will be inside the main production building by early next month. The only piece still seeming to lag behind is the office building. It appeared to be at the bottom of SpaceX's priority list until they were finally able to acquire one last piece of land near the office building, which we discussed in the last episode. Looking over at the office building, we can see that SpaceX has continued its work. They've installed more and more of the glass panels that will make up the wall. We can also see the continued work on the connection between the Starfactory and the office building. Hopefully, this construction will be done soon so SpaceX can begin working towards its goal of building 100 Starships a year from this one facility. Musk also gave a new update on the estimated Flight 5 launch date. On August 10th, he replied to an X post saying that the launch is about 3 weeks out. This would currently put it on no earlier than August 31st, which fits with the current tower stack development. But regulatory approval from the FAA still keeps the next flight on the ground for now. SpaceX is known for working on several crazy projects at the same time. Let's take a look at what else they have been tinkering with. Let's take a look at their next crewed mission, Polaris Dawn. This mission likely needs very little introduction, but for those unaware of Jared Isaacman's private missions, you're in for a treat. Polaris Dawn will be tech billionaire Jared Isaacman's second commercial mission with SpaceX. The first one, called Inspiration 4, was the first full commercial crewed space mission in history. Other than being a really cool mission, Inspiration 4 also sought to raise money for St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital. Talking about success, it raised nearly $250 million. After this mission, Isaacman clearly caught the space bug even more than before. He bought not just one more mission with SpaceX, but three, including the first crew flight on board a Starship. Polaris Dawn is the first of these missions in the new Polaris program, but even though it is the first, that doesn't mean they are starting small. It will include the first commercial spacewalk in spaceflight history, which utilizes a brand new spacesuit developed by SpaceX for this very purpose. The mission is supposed to demonstrate the suit for the first time. Multiple scientific experiments will also be conducted during the mission to determine how the human body reacts to such an environment. This will all be done while flying farther from Earth than any previous human mission since Apollo 17, which went to the moon in 1972. The original target date for this mission was going to be in late 2022.
Oh, I don't even wear a watch.
However, after some delays, it was eventually pushed to late July of 2024 when it appeared they had a pretty good chance of launching. Unfortunately for the Polaris mission, the rocket they were going to ride to space, the Falcon 9, suffered an anomaly in early July. Many of us believed that due to the anomaly, SpaceX would need to postpone many of its crewed missions for a significant amount of time to give its team time to ensure the Falcon 9 was safe. However, it appears that many of us have also forgotten to consider that SpaceX is no ordinary space company, even when it comes to accident investigation. It took SpaceX just 16 days to go from accident to reflight. Since then, they have completed a total of 10 more missions to date with no further problems. So, despite the accident, Polaris suffered only a tiny delay, getting pushed back a mere month. But if it got pushed back a month, doesn't that mean it's soon? Yes, and that is why I'm talking about it now. We have a date. August 26th is Polaris Dawn's new launch date. Yep, that means this Polaris mission is only 10 days away at the time of this video's release. Announced in February 2020, we have been waiting patiently for this launch, and after a few delays, it is finally here. You can be sure we'll be covering this groundbreaking mission all the way to splashdown. Subscribe if you want to see that. The SpaceX Crew Dragon team has a busy rest of the year ahead of it. With Polaris Dawn, Crew 8's return, Crew 9's launch, and Fram 2, there is much to do. Wait, what was that last one? Fram 2? What in low Earth orbit is that? Yep, another crew mission is set to launch this year, making it 3 crewed launches in just a few months. That has to be a new record. Fram 2 is being commanded by Chun Wang, a Bitcoin entrepreneur from Malta, along with Janneke Mikkelsen, Eric Phillips, and Rabea Rogge. An interesting note about these crew members is that none of them are actually from the United States. That makes this the first fully non-American spaceflight to launch on an American capsule. On top of that, Rabea Rogge, as you might notice I'm pronouncing this differently, will be the first female German astronaut to fly to space. Similar to Inspiration 4 and Polaris Dawn, this mission will be a full commercial and free-flying mission, therefore it will not dock at the International Space Station. This also means it'll be equipped with the cupola module seen on the Inspiration 4 mission. Following the theme of polar being a core part of the mission, going from Polaris Dawn to a polar mission seems fitting. I say that because this mission will be the first crew mission to fly over Earth's polar region. This is where the name of Fram 2 comes from, as the original Fram was an Arctic exploring vessel in the late 1800s, a ship. It is unlikely to be directly over the poles, as they have quite a bit of radiation from the Van Allen belts, which can clearly be seen in the Aurora Borealis. This, by the way, is the main reason why they never fly crew above the poles. However, they are likely to try to get as close as possible to perform research on this environment. This will only be a 3 to 5 day mission. But at the time, the crew plans to complete multiple scientific experiments, including the first X-ray performed in space. This mission will definitely be a treat to watch. It's been incredible to see all of those opportunities that SpaceX's commercially available Dragon capsule has provided. These early adopters of spaceflight technology are paving the way for more general consumption later down the line, and I am very much looking forward to that. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button, subscribe for more awesome content. This is what fuels the algorithm and it does help us immensely. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A link is in the description. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching and I'll see you again in the next episode. How long? till I spit my lip. Others have been prepared. Not too long late. Laughter. Not too long late. Laughter.